Building a Taylor polynomial. Objectives. By the end of this lesson, you should be able to write the formula for building a Taylor polynomial, find a Taylor polynomial of order degree n centered at x equals a, given a function f of x, find a Taylor polynomial of order or degree n centered at x equals a, given information about f of x, explain the difference between the degree and order of a Taylor polynomial. Find pieces of information about f of x given a Taylor polynomial. Recite the Taylor polynomials for sine x, cosine x, e to the x, arctangent x, and 1 over 1 minus x. Apply knowledge of the geometric series test to write certain Taylor polynomials. And use known Taylor polynomials to find other Taylor polynomials. Okay, so let's start by taking a detailed look at the Taylor polynomial for f of x centered at x equals a. So t sub n of x, so n being the order of the polynomial, equals f of a plus f prime of a over 1 factorial times x minus a to the 1 plus the second derivative at a over 2 factorial times x minus a quantity squared, plus, and we keep going until we reach the nth derivative at a over n factorial times x minus a to the n, where n is the order of the Taylor polynomial we were in search of. But when we talk about polynomials, it makes sense to talk about the degree. So the degree of a Taylor polynomial, or really any polynomial, is the highest exponent of x that you see in the polynomial. And that may be different than the order n of a Taylor polynomial, which is the order of the highest derivative used to compute the polynomial. So if I want the third order Taylor polynomial, I have to use three derivatives. I have to get to the third derivative of f and evaluate that at a. But it might turn out that the third derivative evaluated at a is 0. So if that's the case, if this is a 0 over 3 factorial, then this whole term right here, which would be the last term, which would have an x to the third power, well, that whole thing would end up being 0. So that doesn't mean that the third order Taylor polynomial doesn't exist, because 0 is a value for the derivative. It just means that this whole term wouldn't be part of the Taylor polynomial, so we would stop, and the highest power of x would be 2. So the third order Taylor polynomial would actually have a degree of 2. So the important part here is that the order is always greater than or equal to the degree of the Taylor polynomial. And often they will be the same, but you'll see and be able to recognize some of the functions that do have this situation where in some cases the order is greater than the degree. Okay, so let's start with a simple one and then work our way up in difficulty from there. So given f of 0 equals 5 and f prime of 0 equals negative 3, find a first order Maclaurin polynomial for f. Alright, so here we haven't actually been given f. We've been given pieces of information about f. So f of 0 equals 5 and f prime of 0 equals negative 3. So if I want to find a first order Maclaurin polynomial, so first let's break it down. Maclaurin means that the center, A, equals 0. And first order means that the highest derivative I'm going to need in order to find this polynomial is the first derivative. So I have the first derivative, f prime, evaluated at 0, which is important because we need the Maclaurin polynomial. So the general formula, just to get some practice, so we're looking for t sub 1 of x. So I really want to make sure that we don't end up substituting an a right here. We want our answer to have x's in it because it's going to be a polynomial of the variable x. So the general formula says I want f of a. So a is 0, so I want f of 0 plus f prime of 0 over 1 factorial times x minus a, a being 0 again, to the 1. Now I stop once I've hit the order that I was looking for. So I was looking for a first order, so I stop when I've used the first derivative. So what we're really doing here is we're finding the equation of the tangent line. So f of 0 is 5 plus f prime of 0 is negative 3, and x minus 0 is just x. So t sub 1 of x, the first order Maclaurin polynomial for f, is 5 plus negative 3x, which is just 5 minus 3x. So the first order Taylor polynomial is a line. And we're done with the first example. So we've done this before, but now we're just attaching some different notation to it. A function f has the following properties. F of 1 equals 2, f prime of 1 equals negative 1, f double prime of 1 equals 1 half, and f triple prime of 1 equals 3. Write the second and third order Taylor polynomials for f. Which is the better approximation for f near x equals 1 and y? So let's start with the first part of the question. Write the second and third order Taylor polynomials. So we would need the second and third derivative for the function at the particular a value. So we do have the original function value at 1, the derivative at 1, the second derivative at 1, and the third derivative at 1. So to write the second and third order Taylor polynomials, we do have enough information. Because the information has all been given at the x value 1, we've then found our center. So our center is a equals 1. So let's go ahead and write the general formula for the second order Taylor polynomial. So t sub 2 of x would be f of 1 plus f prime of 1 times x minus 1 to the 1. So what I'm skipping here is this would be f prime of a over 1 factorial. So a is 1, so f prime of 1 over 1 times x minus a, my a value is 1 to the 1, plus f double prime of 1 over 2 factorial times x minus 1 squared. And we're done because we were trying to find the second order Taylor polynomial. And we're done up until we plug in all the information that we have. So f of 1 was 2 plus f prime of 1 was negative 1. So times x minus 1 plus f double prime of 1 is 1 half. So 1 half over 2 factorial is 2 times x minus 1 squared. So we wouldn't actually want to leave it like this. I just want to clarify, I would definitely not expand this. So I wouldn't want to FOIL x minus 1 times x minus 1 or distribute. But I would want to simplify the coefficients. So this is going to be 2 plus negative 1 is really minus x minus 1 plus, so 1 half over 2 is 1 fourth. So 1 half divided by 2 over 1. If I multiply by the reciprocal of 2 over 1, 1 half times 1 half is 1 fourth. Times x minus 1 squared. So I can go ahead and leave my answer like this. So this is the second, got a little crooked there. This is the second order Taylor polynomial for our function f centered near x equals 1. So now if I want the third order Taylor polynomial, I shouldn't really write this whole thing out again. I know that it's going to include this entire thing, so we can just go ahead and rewrite that. So t sub 3 of x equals 2 minus x minus 1 plus 1 fourth x minus 1 squared plus, so now I stopped at the second derivative evaluated at 1. For the third order Taylor polynomial, I need f triple prime of 1 over 3 factorial times x minus 1 cubed. And now I can go ahead and substitute in my information. So 2 minus x minus 1 plus 1 fourth x minus 1 squared plus f triple prime of 1 was 3 over 3 factorial, so 3 times 2 times 1 is 6, times x minus 1 cubed. So let's make some more space. So my third order Taylor polynomial, 2 minus x minus 1 plus 1 fourth times x minus 1 squared plus 1 half times x minus 1 cubed. And I'll try to make it a little bit more nicer, a little nicer of a box this time. There we go. All right, so my second order, my third order Taylor polynomial for f centered at x equals a. So now let's look at that second question. Which is the better approximation for f near x equals 1 and y? We actually could have answered this question before we even found each of the Taylor polynomials, because as we start to increase the number of terms, we're going to have a better and better approximation of the original function. So once I get to higher order Taylor polynomials, I start to get better and better approximations the further I get from the center being 1. So near x equals 1, which is the better approximation? Well, near x equals 1, really, really close to it, they're both going to be really good, but as I continue to move further away, the better one is going to be the third order Taylor polynomial. So we would just want to summarize that by saying that a Taylor polynomial, I'll abbreviate polynomial, of a higher order / degree is a better approximation near the center. And that's it for this second example. All right, in this example, find the fifth order Maclaurin polynomial for f of x equals sine x near x equals 0. So the function is sine x and the center is 0, although we could have gathered that from the fact that we were asked for a Maclaurin polynomial. And we need the fifth order Maclaurin polynomial. So I'm going to write the general formula for a Taylor polynomial of order 5 centered at 0. So t sub 5 of x is going to be f of 0 plus f prime of 0 times x. So what I'm doing is I'm really going to shorthand this, because technically this is x minus a, so minus 0 to the 1, which is just x, plus f double prime of 0 over 2, so 2 factorial is 2, times x squared. So I really didn't need the parentheses there. If you want to shorthand it even more, it's just f double prime 0 over 2 times x squared, no parentheses, plus f triple prime of 0 over 3 factorial, which is 6, times x cubed, plus the fourth derivative, and we'd stop using the prime notation here, at 0 over 4 factorial times x to the fourth, plus the fifth derivative at 0 over 5 factorial times x to the fifth. So 4 factorial happens to be 24, and as we do more of these, you'll figure out the patterns. And 5 factorial is 120, so I'm just going to erase those for now and fill them in. So 4 factorial is 24, 5 factorial is 120, because there's already a whole lot of other things we're going to need to plug in. All right, so what we need is, if I want the fifth order Maclaurin polynomial, I need 5 derivatives. And on this particular problem, I wasn't given pieces of information about the function, I was just given the function. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to do some scratch work on the side. So I have to figure out the first 5 derivatives of sine x. So f of x is sine x, f prime of x is cosine x, f double prime of x is negative sine x, f triple prime of x is negative cosine x. The fourth derivative of x finally gets me back to sine x, and the fifth derivative at x is going to give me cosine x. All right, so we needed the first 5 derivatives, and now technically we need the first 5 derivatives evaluated at 0. So f of 0, sine 0 is 0, f prime of 0, cosine 0 is 1, f double prime of 0, negative sine 0, well, sine 0 is still 0, so negative 0 is 0. The third derivative at 0, so cosine of 0 was 1, there's a negative this time, so negative 1. And then we start this pattern again. So the fourth derivative at 0 is 0, and the fifth derivative at 0 is 1. Oy. So now, we have to take all this information and plug it into this formula for the fifth order Maclaurin polynomial. So I will go ahead and start to do that. Now, f of 0 is 0, so there's no need to write that part. F prime of 0 is 1, so this quantity here is 1, so all that's left is x. And now, f double prime of 0, so the second derivative at 0 was 0. So if this top part is 0, sort of doing a different color, so if this top part is 0, 0 over 2 is 0 times x squared, well, times anything is just 0. So f of 0, this was 0, this one was 0, and let's just fill out the last part that's going to be 0, the fourth derivative. So this portion right here is 0. So none of these terms are even going to show up in the Maclaurin polynomial. So what is going to be left over is the third derivative at 0, so that was a negative 1, over 6 times x cubed, and then the fifth derivative at 0, that was 1, so plus 1 over 120 x to the fifth. So I'm going to bring this negative down so that it doesn't look like it's a minus, or it is a minus, it doesn't look like a negative. So the polynomial is x minus 1 over 6x cubed plus 1 over 120 x to the fifth. So in this case, the fifth order Maclaurin polynomial happened to also be a fifth degree Maclaurin polynomial, because the highest exponent with the x is a 5 here. But do you see how potentially we could ended up possibly losing the degree because every other derivative resulted in a 0? So that's how sometimes the degree ends up being less than the order. In this case, it stuck around, but if I wanted to find the sixth order Maclaurin polynomial, so let's just go one more out. So let's say the derivative at 6, cosine x, the derivative of cosine is negative sine x. When I substitute in 0, I'm going to get out 0. So if I wanted the sixth order Maclaurin polynomial, it's actually going to be the same thing as the fifth order Maclaurin polynomial, because I'm adding on the sixth derivative at 0 over whatever 6 factorial is, 720, and then x to the 6, but this portion, the sixth derivative at 0 is 0, so this top part's going to go away, so it's like putting a plus 0 here. So, in other words, the fifth order Maclaurin polynomial is the same as the sixth order Maclaurin polynomial. But the fifth order has degree 5, and the sixth order has degree 5, because we lost that final term. All right, in this next example, find the third order Taylor polynomial for f of x equals the square root of x near x equals 1. So let's write the generic third order Taylor polynomial formula for a center of 1. So t sub 3 of x equals f of 1 plus f prime of 1 times x minus 1 plus the second derivative at 1 over 2 factorial times x minus 1 squared plus the third derivative at 1 over 3 factorial times x minus 1 cubed. So we're going to need to fill in our pieces of information, our f of 1, our f prime of 1, our f double prime of 1, and f triple prime of 1. So we need the first, second, and third derivatives of the square root of x. So f of x equals the square root of x. So here's my scratch work over here. And this is x to the 1/2. So if I want the first derivative, that's 1 over 2 x to the negative 1/2. That's 1 over 2 rad x. The second derivative is going to be negative 1/4 x to the negative 3 over 2. So I'm going to rewrite that as 1 over 4x to the 3 over 2. And the third derivative is going to end up being positive 3 over 8x to the negative 5 over 2. So that's 3 over 8x to the positive 5 over 2. So you can see, hopefully, that Taylor polynomials can get a little bit messy in all the work that we have to do if the function that we need to take the derivative of ends up having a little bit more complicated derivatives every single time. So this one wasn't as bad, and because our a value is 1, it's not going to end up being too much work to plug 1 into each of these functions. So f of 1, the square root of 1 is 1, f prime of 1, So when I plug in 1 down here, I'm going to get 1 half f double prime of 1. So imagine plugging 1 into this x right here. 1 to the anything is 1, so this is going to be negative 1 fourth. And the third derivative at 1, again, if I plug 1 in right here, 1 to the anything is 1, so this would be 3 over 8. So now I need to plug that into this formula right here. So the Taylor polynomial is going to end up equaling, so let's just box this off to the side. So you always want to do your scratch work off on the side to not get it mixed up with the actual polynomial. So this is going to equal f of 1, which was 1, plus f prime of 1. F prime of 1 was 1 half, so 1 half x minus 1, plus f double prime of 1, that was negative 1 fourth. So minus 1 fourth over, almost forgot a key part, 2 factorial, x minus 1 squared, plus the third derivative at 1, that was 3 eighths, so 3 over 8 over 3 factorial times x minus 1 cubed. So now let's try to simplify this. This is 1 plus 1 half x minus 1. This is a negative 1 fourth over a 2. 2 factorial is 2. So this is negative 1 eighth. So I multiplied negative 1 fourth times the reciprocal of 2. That's 1 half. So 1 fourth times 1 half is 1 over 8. X minus 1 squared plus, so now I have, let's pull this off to the side, 3 over 8 over 3 factorial. That's 6. So that's 3 over 8. Times the reciprocal of 6, 1 over 6, these will reduce, so I get 1 over 16. So plus 1 over 16 x minus 1 cubed. So this whole thing is my third order Taylor polynomial for the square root function near x equals 1. Alright, so in this next example, we're going to work backwards. Let's say we're given the Taylor polynomial of order 4 is this whole thing right here for some function f. And we want to find all of these pieces of information. So what's a? What's the center? What's f of a, f prime of a, f double prime of a, triple prime of a, and the fourth derivative at a? So this right here is the Taylor polynomial. So right above it, I'm going to write what the generic form of the fourth order Taylor polynomial would be. So this, in other words, is f of a. Well, let's just go ahead and say right now what the a value is. A is definitely 1 because our formula has x minus a all over the place. So clearly our a value is 1. So this is f of 1 plus f prime of 1 over 1 factorial times x minus 1 plus f double prime of 1 over 2 factorial times x minus 1 squared plus f triple prime of 1 over 3 factorial times x minus 1 squared plus the fourth derivative at 1. Got a little messy there. This pen's probably too thick. 4 factorial times x minus 1 to the fourth. That doesn't look like 3. All right. So this is the generic fourth order Taylor polynomial. So let's try to match which pieces go with which. So f of 1 is going to be this part right here. F prime of 1 over 1 factorial, so really just f prime of 1 is going to be 3. And where we're going to have to start doing some work is f double prime of 1 over 2 factorial. This whole piece ends up being negative 2. So that's where we're going to have to start doing some work. So here a was 1, f of a, well that's like asking for f of 1. F of 1 is exactly 2. And it's here where we're going to have to start doing some work. So f double prime of 1 over 2 factorial, well that's just f double prime of 1 over 2. That has to equal negative 2. So now I'm setting up an equation. I'm solving this equation here, which if I want f double prime of 1, I have to multiply both sides by 2. So f double prime of 1 equals negative 2 times 2, which equals 4. So a was 1. F of a, which is f of 1, is 2. And then f double prime of 1 equals 4. So we're going to have to do the same setup with the next coefficient. So f triple prime of 1 over 3 factorial has to equal positive 1/3. So f triple prime of 1 over 3 factorial is 6 is going to have to equal 1 over 3. So if I multiply both sides of this by 6, then f triple prime of 1 is going to have to equal 2. And then finally, I'm looking for the fourth derivative at a, so I'm going to have to take this whole coefficient, the fourth derivative at 1 over 4 factorial, let's see if I have space, the fourth derivative at 1 over 4 factorial is going to have to equal negative 1 over 6. So now, 4 factorial, let's just rewrite that as 24. I'd have to multiply both sides of this thing by 24. So the fourth derivative at 1 is going to be negative 4. So a was 1. F of a, which is f of 1, was 2. F double prime of 1 is 4. F triple prime of 1 was 2. And the fourth derivative at 1 was negative 4. So it was working our way backwards and knowing the general formula for nth order Taylor polynomial that allowed us to find some information about f at the center value of 1. All right, so now here are some Taylor polynomials you just need to know. In other words, you have to memorize them. And it seems like a lot, but you'll get used to it and you'll recognize the patterns in each one. So that's what we'll sort of talk about here. So e to the x with a center of a equals 0, so this is a Maclaurin polynomial. To find the nth order polynomial, we're going to take 1 plus x squared over 2 factorial, x cubed over 3 factorial, all the way up to x to the n, whatever the order is, over n factorial. So this is the nth order Maclaurin polynomial for e to the x. So notice they're all added together, and all of them go up by 1 every single time. So sine x and cosine x. So sine x centered at a equals 0, we've explored this one a little bit. To find the order 2n plus 1 Taylor polynomial, and what that means right here is that it's really only worth it to find the odd order Taylor polynomials. Because as we saw for the example with sine, the fifth and sixth order polynomial were exactly the same thing. So it's not worth it to compute every single one because those corresponding pairs are going to be the same every single time. So the general formula is x minus x cubed over 3 factorial plus x to the fifth over 5 factorial plus dot 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 up until the general term says that, well, the terms are going to alternate. This negative 1 to the 2n plus 1, notice I had x minus plus, and it's going to keep alternating back and forth. So to be really accurate, this should be a minus sign right here to indicate that the next term would be a negative. And then the last term, I mean, maybe positive or negative based on whatever we're stopping with. So negative 1 to the 2n plus 1 means it's alternating. X to the 2n plus 1, that just means that this exponent has to be odd over that same exponent factorial. So a little trick that sort of might help you remember this is that the sine function is considered to be a function that is symmetric with respect to the origin. And another word for that is the sine function is an odd function as opposed to an even function, so that functions can be odd, even, or neither. So sine is an odd function, and that's exactly where this comes from, because the Taylor polynomial is a bunch of odd degrees every single time. And sine and cosine both alternate. So now let's take a look at the cosine Taylor polynomial centered at 0. It's only going to be worth it to find the even order Taylor polynomials for the exact same reason that the corresponding ones right next to each other are going to end up being the same. So the cosine Taylor polynomial is going to start at 1 this time. So 1 minus x squared over 2 factorial plus x to the 4th over 4 factorial. And again, to be accurate, that should be a minus to indicate the next term would be a negative. It'd be negative x to the 6 over 6 factorial. We're going to alternate again until we get to x to the 2n over 2n factorial. So cosine of 0 is 1. So hopefully maybe that will help you remember that the cosine function starts at 1 and then it alternates and all of the powers are even because cosine is an even function. There's symmetry with respect to the x-axis. And that indicates that each of these exponents here has to be even. And then arctangent x centered at a equals 0. So the nth Taylor polynomial is going to be x minus x cubed over 3 plus x to the 5th over 5 minus x to the 7th over 7. So a lot of times people get confused and think it's the same as the sine Taylor polynomial, but the difference, and it's a slight one, is that there are no factorials for arctangent. So it's almost the same as the sine function, but the denominators of each of the terms is just the number, not including a factorial. So the signs alternate the same way in everything. We're just missing the factorial for arctangent. And then finally, 1 over 1 minus x centered at a equals 0. That Taylor polynomial is 1 plus x squared plus dot 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 up to x to the n. And you might be thinking, well, these functions, I understand why I need to memorize their Taylor polynomial, but what's special about 1 over 1 minus x? So we're going to focus on that in the next section. So let's take a look more at 1 over 1 minus x, which is approximately, using the Taylor polynomial, 1 plus x squared plus x cubed plus x to the n. So let's take a closer look at the right side. 1 plus x squared plus x cubed. Plus all the way up to x to the n. So to get from one term to the next, so I'm looking at the terms in the sequence right now. So just 1, x, x squared, x cubed. So forget the fact that we're adding them together. To get from 1 to x, I would need to multiply by an x. To get from x to x squared, I'd have to multiply by an x. X squared to x cubed, I'd have to multiply by an x. So when I have to multiply to get from one term to the next, we should be thinking about a geometric series. So in fact, the right side here is actually a geometric series where the first term is 1 and the common ratio to get from 1 to the next is x, and then we would need it raised to the nth power. So where n equals 0, and we've talked about infinite geometric series. So let's think about this. If I started by substituting in a 0, anything to the 0 is 1, I get out that first term. So this is 1 plus x squared plus x cubed plus all the way up to x to the n. But what's also interesting about having an infinite geometric series is that we can talk about what it converges to. So this series converges if the absolute value, so let's write it out, this series converges if the absolute value of x, because x is in that common ratio position, so below it, let's go ahead and write a r to the n. So r in this case is my x. So if x is, the absolute value of this thing is less than 1, then this thing converges, and it converges to a over 1 minus r. Well, in our case, my a value is 1 over 1 minus my r value was x, which, if you look, was exactly the original function, 1 over 1 minus x. So 1 over 1 minus x is equal to 1 plus x squared plus x cubed plus all the way up to x to the n. But again, there's this whole part where this is only true when the absolute value of x is less than 1, that's when you know an infinite geometric series converges. And, well, what about the fact that this portion over here on the right side actually stops, right? This doesn't go on forever like an infinite geometric series does. So that's why this is just an approximation. So it turns out that, in fact, if I put 1 over 1 minus x and I include plus dot 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 on the right-hand side, this approximation becomes a true equal sign. And that's what we're building towards at the end of this chapter, is that we're going to try, or actually we're going to succeed in finding ways to exactly represent a function using what looks like polynomials, but they're not actually going to be polynomials because polynomials end and this infinite series goes on forever. But that's why this one is so important. And we can use this same trick, sort of, to figure out an expanded Taylor polynomial for something of this form. So for a function of this form, like a 1 over 1 minus x, I'm going to end up using this sort of trick of a geometric series to write out its expanded Taylor polynomial. So let's see an example of that. All right, so now I want to find the Maclaurin polynomial of degree 6 for 3 over 1 minus 2x. So I'm going to use my little trick in recognizing that this is of the form a over 1 minus r, which would be the sum of a converging geometric series. So I can pretty easily recognize that my a value is 3 and my r value is 2x. Now let's stop before we actually apply this little trick and think about what would happen if we didn't have it and if we wanted to find the Maclaurin polynomial of degree 6 for this function. Maclaurin polynomial meaning that the center is 0, so we have that. We need the polynomial to be of degree 6, which means that we might need to go out one further and find the 7th derivative, potentially, of 3 over 1 minus 2x so that we can plug 0 into that 7th derivative, but at least 6 derivatives of this function. So that would not be a nice function to take 6 or 7 derivatives of. So instead, we use the fact that this would be the sum of a converging geometric series. So a is 3, r is 2x. So now what that geometric series would look like is going to be the answer to our Maclaurin polynomial, and we're going to get to stop whenever we hit a degree 6 Taylor polynomial. So my geometric series is going to be from n equals 0 to infinity of my a value 3 times r, so that would be 2x, to the n. And now our job is to expand it out. So if I substitute in 0, anything to the 0 is 1, so the first term will just be 3. Then I substitute in 1, so 3 times 2x to the 1, and then 3 times 2x squared, plus 3 times 2x cubed, plus 3 times 2x to the 4th, plus 3 times 2x to the 5th, plus 3 times 2x to the 6th, plus dot dot dot. So technically this infinite series goes on forever, but I stopped once I took 2x to the 6th because I was told I want a Maclaurin polynomial of degree 6. So 3 plus 6x plus, let's do all this multiplying, this is 2 squared, which is 4, times 3 is 12, so 12x squared, 2 cubed is 8, 8 times 3 is 24, so plus 24x cubed, plus 2 to the 4th, that's 16 times 3 is 48x to the 4th. And now maybe hopefully we can see a pattern. So 2 to the 5th is 32. 32 times 3 is 96, which also happens to be double 48. So if you notice the coefficients, they're doubling every single time. So 96x to the 5th plus, so now I would have to double 96, so I would end up getting out 192x to the 6th. Now, of course, this thing does go on forever, but we would stop and say that the Maclaurin polynomial of degree 6 is this whole thing without the plus dot dot dot, because a polynomial has to end and it has to be of degree 6. So this part right here is my answer. So it's a lot shorter than trying to find the 6th and potentially 7th derivative of this function, substituting in 0, and then writing out the whole expanded formula for a Taylor polynomial centered at 0. Alright, so in the last example, I want to find the Maclaurin polynomial of degree 6 for sine of x squared. So the strategies that we've used so far, I can't use that geometric series trick on this problem, but I can use a manipulation of the Maclaurin polynomial I already know for just the sine function. So here's what we know. We know that sine x is approximately x minus x cubed over 3 factorial plus x to the 5th over 5 factorial minus x to the 7th over 7 factorial plus and so on and so forth up until negative 1 to the 2n plus 1 x to the 2n plus 1 over 2n plus 1 factorial. So this is what sine x is approximately using its Taylor polynomial. Well, the nice thing is that if I already know this, which this is one of the ones you need to have memorized, then to find the Maclaurin polynomial for sine of x squared, anywhere there's an x in this formula, I'm just going to replace it with x squared. So for this x, for this x, for this x, for this x, but I don't even actually have to go that far because I was told to find a Maclaurin polynomial of degree 6. So in other words, sine of x squared is then approximately x squared minus x squared cubed over 3 factorial is 6. And in fact, I can stop there because this is my property of exponents that says I can multiply these two. So this is the same as x squared minus x to the 6 over 6 factorial. So the Maclaurin polynomial of degree 6, this polynomial has degree 6, is x squared minus x to the 6 over 6, or 1 sixth x to the 6. And I'm done. So it was a lot nicer than finding how many derivatives, at least 6 derivatives of sine of x squared, which would be a chain rule and then a chain rule and a product rule and a whole bunch of other stuff that we wouldn't want to have to do if we don't have to do it. So if we know what the Maclaurin polynomial is for sine x, and the only important thing to remember here is that this was the Maclaurin polynomial. In other words, the center was 0. And then on this problem, they're asking you again for the Maclaurin polynomial, so the center is 0. But if they said the Taylor polynomial of degree 6 for sine of x squared at x equals 1 or a equals 1, well, now we're just out of luck. We actually have to go through the whole process. So this only works if we can use the original Maclaurin polynomials that were part of that list that we just need to have memorized.